A very good evening, everyone. Hope you all are safe and doing well. We are back with a new Fresh Talk this weekend. Thank you all for enrolling in this event. Excel and Excel welcomes you all. Let me give you a gist about Excel and Excel. Excel and Excel is a data analytics firm that solves high impact business problems using data and technology. We provide end-to-end services in the field of data analytics and data visualization. Our core services include analytics, consulting, and training. Excel and Excel presents the popular talk show, EIE Fresh Talk, on its YouTube channel, where it hosts great leaders and subject matter experts in various fields from India and abroad to speak regularly on a variety of topics ranging from Excel to analytics and finance to financial modeling and many more. Few of our past events are 5 must-have charts in any finance person's toolbox by Chandu, 7 Excel features pros use to be more efficient by Sumit Bansal, how to build professional looking financial models by Tim Henk, automate sending emails from MS Excel using VBA scripts by Patrick Samborski. Today's talk is about 9 presentation hacks with PowerPoint presented by Mr. Geetesh Bajaj. Mr. Geetesh is an internationally acclaimed PowerPoint, storyboarding, infodiagramming, and presenting expert who has been awarded as a Microsoft MVP, Most Valuable Professional, every year for 20 years now, making him the longest serving MVP in India. As an MVP, Geetesh interacts and collaborates with the Microsoft PowerPoint product development team. He is also on the board of directors for the Presentation Guide, a presentation industry trade association based out of Cincinnati, USA. Based out of Hyderabad, India, he believes that any presentation is a sum of its elements. These include abstract elements like story, concept, color, interactivity, and navigation, and slide elements like shapes, graphics, charts, text, sound, video, and animation. Geetesh has authored 6 books. His InDesign.com site attracts many page views each month and has thousands of free PowerPoint templates and other goodies for visitors to download. In addition, Geetesh also issues a weekly PowerPoint newsletter on InDesign.com. We welcome you, sir. It's truly a privilege and a pleasure having you with us. Before we begin, I request participants to join me in welcoming today's speaker with a hi in the chat section. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the question box. We will later present it to the speaker. Over to you, sir.
Okay, hi everybody, and thank you, Elinda, for the introduction. Can I go ahead and share my screen now, Elinda?
Yes, sir.
So, thank you. So can all of you see my first screen?
Yes, sir, we can see.
Okay, just give me a moment. Okay, so good evening, everyone. It's great to be here. So what we're going to do today is we have the session actually in 2 parts. The smaller earlier part was going to go through a bunch of slides, PowerPoint slides, definitely. And the later part, we'll go through some hacks and demo them in PowerPoint for all of you so that you can actually go and learn those hacks and use them on your own almost immediately after the session, if you please. Okay, so with that, let's get started. Okay, 30 million PowerPoint decks, call them presentations, whatever you want. That's the number of presentations created every single day. And this is a figure that was released by Microsoft 13 years ago. Compare how many presentations you made 13 years ago with how many you make today. And you know it's a huge, huge number. So the question is, who makes these presentations? Why are there so many presentations, okay? And what does this mean for all of us today who are attending this session? So we are living in a world that is surrounded by PowerPoint. So wherever you look, you'll encounter a PowerPoint presentation in some way. If there's a proposal, a business proposal, an idea, or some funding, or even something in kindergarten school or upper higher education, you're going to encounter a PowerPoint presentation in some way. So these, as we said, are created by big business houses. It's a lot of PowerPoint presentations and slides are used in training, in education, right from kindergarten to higher education, universities, distance learning, you name it, and a PowerPoint slide is used as a way to educate. And definitely the governments, politicians, UN, non-governmental bodies, everywhere. So, and also there are, these are the four large areas where PowerPoint is used other than business, okay, that is marketing, and definitely marketing is business, and medicine and law is also business, but religion, let's not call that a business. Okay, so what we actually looked as is we're going to use a metaphor now. The metaphor is tip of the iceberg, and that is characteristics of almost any PowerPoint presentation that you create, see, or part of. Okay, so what's an iceberg? We have a picture of an iceberg, which is pretty representative of what we want to go and tell you all. The smaller part of the iceberg is what is typically visible to us, that's on above the surface of the water. But almost 4 to 5 times the size of this iceberg that you see above the tip of the water is something which is under the water. That's very important. If that colossal mass was not there underwater, the remaining part that's above the water would not be visible to you. It wouldn't be there. It would sink. Okay. So the only reason that the part that you see above the water surface is visible and exists is because it has got something supporting it underneath. And that's where the metaphor is very well known, tip of the iceberg, because there's more to the iceberg than the tip. Okay. So let's look at not the tip of the iceberg, but what is below the iceberg now, below the tip of the iceberg. This is what you, most of you do. And definitely this is representative of the audience that we have today, which is mainly related to Excel, okay? So you work with a lot of stuff, accounts, clients, you work with stats, and you do research, and you have tons of emails and messaging calls, phone, and you have your findings, you have your data, and then you attend webinars, and that is just, you know, just saying a bit of it. I'm sure you do a whole lot more. But when you go and take your findings, your research, your work, or even contain in an Excel and put it in a PowerPoint slide and present it to someone who's important, what do they see? They see your PowerPoint slide, because more often than not, you're actually going and presenting your content in your PowerPoint slides. So you're, 1 second, I think. So based on how your PowerPoint slide looks like, the work it does, that's the opinion that the superior or the boss is forming about you. Now, it's not fair. We don't live in a fair world, okay? But PowerPoint is larger than life, and that's a fact. Because if you have a huge Excel sheet and you have a spelling mistake somewhere in that, or maybe even a formula error that is not too significant to really bother, so it is not going to be really make a big issue. But if you have a title of a PowerPoint slide and just has a spelling mistake over there, then you're advertising something to the whole world. Okay. The opinion that the audience forms about you at that time is instantaneous. Okay. And that cannot be changed because they've already formed an opinion. So it's not fair. It is not how it should be, but it's still a fact that PowerPoint is larger than life. Okay. And so if you are good at everything else, but poor at PowerPoint, so it's like a cake without an icing, okay? The cake is still good, but it's the icing that really makes it, you know, be so much better. And in the same way, if you're good at PowerPoint and then you're not good at anything else, so it really doesn't matter how well you say it because you have nothing to say. So the important takeaway that I want to bring across to all of you here is that it's important that you're good at everything else, but it is even important that you be good at PowerPoint so that you can present your data in a way that is effective and will allow people to take decisions in an easier way because you're showing them a trend. You're showing them the gist, the takeaway, the message over there. And that's really the moot point here. So what's wrong with many of the PowerPoints that we create? Okay, there are four factors typically. We'll just go lightly into them. And then we are going to go into 9 hacks later into the session that will help you overcome some of these problems, okay? The first is you have too much text. A lot of people think PowerPoint to be an extension of their Word document, or they think they can just copy and paste their Excel content into their PowerPoint slides. So what happens is it's just too much text over there. Basically, PowerPoint is not something where you can put teeny weeny small size text and go and present it into the audience and then read every single word over there. There's no better way to bore your audience or make them lose interest than doing that. So what you really want to do is not put too much text in your PowerPoint, and you can go and elaborate about that and speak it to your audience. Nothing speaks as loud to your audience that you are not a subject matter expert than putting too much content into your PowerPoint slide. So why do people put so much content? Clearly, they are scared. They forget about something. They don't want to forget that stuff, so they put everything in their slides. Or they don't know anything better because that's what they've seen everyone else do. The second problem is tight deadlines. So why do we have tight deadlines? For two reasons. The first reason is most people in their offices are told that you have to create a PowerPoint presentation at the nth minute, the last minute. And that really does not give them an opportunity to create a better PowerPoint deck. So what they do is they just accumulate everything what they have and quickly make a presentation, and they're happy with that. The second reason is if you told a week ago to make a PowerPoint presentation, what a lot of you will do is, I'm not saying all of you, some of you will say there's a week more for to create a PowerPoint presentation. So let's not worry. Let's go and do our other important work. It's going to take a few hours to make a PowerPoint presentation, and we can make it just one day before the presentation or in the morning of the day we have a presentation. The third option is lacking creativity and lack of education. Okay, now lack of creativity is not something we can get across and teach anyone. That has to come from within. But if you go and look at the dictionary meaning of creativity, it gives you a lot of meanings, but it doesn't give you the meaning I'm going to tell you now. And that's an easy way to get creative. To get creative, get curious. Try and look at other people's decks, slides, ideas, and see how they did that. Try to recreate something like that. Try to be curious about how that was done. Try to be curious about the other ways in which you can present data, present information, present it more effectively in a clean, uncluttered way. Okay, so this is something that has to come from within all of us. And if you want to create better presentations and we want to present our data properly, that's something we will all have to do. Okay, and finally, lack of education. A lot of people, especially those who are doing PowerPoint, are self-taught. They don't go and learn PowerPoint anywhere. Many of them don't even bother to buy a book, okay? Leave aside going for the training program or something of that sort, because they know Word and Excel, and PowerPoint has a similar ribbon tabs and ribbon similar options. Within the next 10, 15 minutes, they can actually create something. So they think they know PowerPoint and they don't need to learn that. And nothing can be further from the truth. They really need to go and learn PowerPoint, because only when they learn it better will they be able to make better slides. So Linda, do we have any questions at this point in time?
Not so far, sir.
Wonderful. So if there's anything at any time and you think it's the right time to answer it, please go ahead and interrupt.
Yes, yeah, sure, sir.
Certainly. Thank you so much. Okay, so now we're going to get to the second part of our session. We're going to look at hacks. Essentially, we're going to look at 9 hacks. So again, you know, when I was told that I had to do a presentation with hacks, so I first went and looked at the dictionary meaning of hacks, and a lot of meanings are not valid for what I'm doing today. Luckily, I found one meaning, because typically words have multiple meanings. And one meaning was a strategy or technique for managing one's time or activities more efficiently. And that seemed to fit what we are doing today very well. So we go, and when, so when we say hack, we mean these strategies and techniques, okay? So let's go ahead and work on these strategies. So there are nine hacks, and these are the nine hacks that we're looking at. Don't bother reading them because we're going to come on all of them individually. I just wanted to create like a table of contents there. So we put up this slide over here, but actually there are more than nine because we're actually going to start with a zero hack, okay? The first hack is your zero hack. So it's PowerPoint, and not only PowerPoint, but because a lot of stuff that, in fact, I think the first five hacks that we're going to learn today are probably valid for Excel and Word as well, because most of the Microsoft Office programs work similarly, okay? So, and the most important hack for PowerPoint, Word, and Excel is about selection and action. So if you want to do something in PowerPoint, you first have to select it, okay? And once you select it, then you can run a command or do an action on that, and something's going to happen as a result, okay? So to do anything, to get the master at PowerPoint, the first thing you have to know is selection techniques. So there are more than one way to select something in PowerPoint. So let's go ahead and share my PowerPoint slide and get started. There you go. So this is our zero hack. And so to select something, you're going to work with PowerPoint. So let's go and put some stuff here. So I'm just going to go and draw the shapes here. Smaller. How I'm duplicating shapes and stuff like that, I'm going to show you all again, so don't worry about that. So I have a bunch of shapes here. Now what if I want to select all shapes on the slide? The easiest way is to use a keyboard shortcut, Ctrl A. It selects everything, but it selects more than a slide. It also selects this text called demo, and it also selects this bookmark like shape that we have here. So let's first go and use another way to select a shape, that is select clicking on it. And when you click on a second object, the first one gets deselected. So what we're going to do is going to select the first one, press the Control or the Shift key, either key works, okay? It's up to you what you want to use. When the moment I press Control, you see the cursor shows a plus sign over there. So I can just go on clicking, and this way I can select whatever I want. What if I do not want to select the small shape there? I can click it for the second time. It gets deselected. So let's go back to Control A now and select all the shapes. So the same way, I can hit Control and click the demo option here. That gets deselected, and the bookmark also gets deselected. So we looked at two ways of selecting shapes. One is by selecting and click Control or Shift clicking other objects, and again Control clicking or Shift clicking again to deselect them, okay? The second way we looked at is Control A as a keyboard shortcut, okay? Now let's look at a third way. That is by dragging a marquee, okay? So I'm going to go out of the slide, and I'm going to click my cursor and drag my cursor over all the shapes that I want to select. So at this point of time, there are six squares on the slide, and I put my marquee like a net over them, but I've not completely covered the sixth square. So any guesses if it's going to select all six or just five? Do you want me to just go and leave the mouse click and see? Yes, so it selects only five of them. So you have to make sure that you cover everything. So now I'm gonna go and cover the sixth shape as well. So I have selected all six of them. So this is the third way of selecting, that is marquee dragging. The fourth way of selecting is you can go to the Home tab, go to Select and hit Selection Pane, okay? And this opens your selection pane. So you can go and individually click on the objects here that you want to select. In fact, if you just go and click here as well, this it gets selected on the selection pane as well. So why is this important? Why is the selection pane important? So let me just go and take this particular square and put it on top of this one. So how do I select the square, the small square that's behind? I can't do that because it's not, if I click it, I'm going to click on the square on top of that. And I don't even know there's a square under that. So if I go into the selection pane and hit on rectangle 4 here, if you can see, and you can see that I've ended up selecting the shape that's under that. So selection pane is very important and easy to use, and it gets you shapes that you would not be able to select otherwise. So this is just another option of selecting objects. So we looked at four options of selecting objects, okay? The another way of selecting shapes is, I know there's something behind here, okay? But I don't know if it's behind this square or this square or this square or somewhere, okay? So I can select the first shape and hit the tab key. And you see it rotates between all objects on the slide. So at some point in time, you'll come and select something over there and you'll know there's a shape behind that. Now this works for slides that have 6, 7, 10, 15 objects, but if you have slides with 200 objects, it's going to be really worrisome. So in that case, you really want to use a selection pane. So this is a fifth way of selecting stuff. So there are lots of ways in PowerPoint to select the stuff. Now these are the five ways we looked at, but the most important part is that you have to understand that you can combine all of them, okay? So if I have selected this particular slide, let's start with Control A. And let me go and deselect this one, and this one, and this one, and this one, and this one. I have only three selected. So now let me move out over here, press the shift key here, and drag again. So it adds to the selection. It adds others to that, okay? And so I use Control A, I use the shift or the control keys to deselect, and then I also use a mark U over there to make my final selection. And if I wanted, I could go and deselect the small one over there by using the selection pane. So you can choose all the five ways of selection of the shapes and then get your final selection. Okay, so with that, let's move on to our real first hack. Our first hack is called keyboard shortcuts, okay? There are more than 300-400 keyboard shortcuts in PowerPoint, and I will give you a recommendation to an ebook later, but let's go and just look at a few of them, okay? So let's look at Control M. So you can always go to new slide, or you can just click this button over there and it adds a new slide. But I could just also press Control M, but sometimes it doesn't work because I think that keyboard shortcut is taken over by Zoom. Well, it works now. So if you press Control M and you add a new slide, okay? It's going to add a new slide in the location that you want. So if I click between these two slides over here, between slides 13 and 14, and hit Control M, it adds a new slide there. So let's go and delete the slide, and we'll go back to this particular slide. Okay, let's go to this particular slide. And I want to right-click this here and say duplicate slide. So it makes a duplicate of the slide. But I can also select it and press Control D, and that's going to make a duplicate of the slide. So the keyboard shortcut for selecting something and then duplicating that is Control D. If I select a slide and hit Control D, it's going to duplicate the slide. But if I select a shape and hit Control D, it's going to duplicate the shape. If I select three shapes and hit Control D, it's going to duplicate all the three shapes. So it's selection and action. Everything we do in PowerPoint is going to work with selection and action. And this technique about duplicating shapes with Control D should work in Excel as well. Okay, so we'll let that. But you know, there are a lot of options, commands in PowerPoint that don't have keyboard shortcuts. So what do you do to make your work fast? And you know they're all there, but if you are a keyboard person and you don't want to go with the mouse click and find stuff like that, for example, if I have these three shapes, okay, and I want them to be aligned top together. So I could actually go here and home, and then I could just go and say arrange, align, and top. But there's no keyboard shortcut for that. So what do I do? Let me press undo Control Z first. So what I can do, I can have a keyboard sequence for practically anything in PowerPoint. To do that, first you hit the Alt key, and it gets you the key that you're going to use for anything over there. So our keyboard option is in the arrange over there in the Home tab. And the Home tab clearly says H. So I'm just going to press the H key. Okay, and now it says arrange. Okay, so for arrange, I have to press, I think it's G. Okay, there you go. And then for align, it is A. I think we lost that. Just give me, let me start it again. Alt, H, G, A. And then I'm going to go and say align top. It's not going to work because I lost the selection here. It's always selection and action. Now we do quick Alt H, G, A, and we're going to go and say align top, which is T. So that works. And In the next tip, I'm going to show you actually how you don't even have to worry about these things and get your frequently used tools on the quick access toolbar. But before we do that, let's go and look at this part over there in this slide. I have a keyboard shortcuts ebook, okay, which retails for around $20. I'm just going to make a note of whatever we work in. If any of you have any questions or something that I need to put in the notes for this presentation on the YouTube page where this is being broadcasted, maybe by tomorrow, there'll be a link to a document where you'll have some freebies and you'll also have a link to a discount code to get this for 75% off. Okay, so now let's look at the QAT. What is the QAT? The QAT stands for the Quick Access Toolbar. Okay, so let's go and look at our interface in PowerPoint. So this is a quick access toolbar. This is a ribbon on the top, and these are the tabs of the ribbon. And just below the ribbon area, this is the quick access toolbar. By default, you only have 3 or 4 commands on the quick access toolbar, but I've added a lot of them. You can see most of these commands are grayed out because I have nothing selected on the slide. The moment I select it, most of the commands are available. There are some commands that are still not available because they are not applicable to text. Now, these commands are applicable to tables. So when I have a table selected, it's going to work. Okay, it depends on that. So what's a QAT? The QAT is typically placed above the ribbon. So when you actually launch PowerPoint by default, and if you've not made any changes, you can right click on your quick access toolbar and say show quick access toolbar above the ribbon. And that's where it shows. And this is again applicable for Excel as well. So I can again right click and say place it below the ribbon. And this is what I always want to use, because why do I want it below the ribbon? Because I have my presentation name there and my account ID and the minimize, maximize, restore buttons and stuff like that. So it gets too complicated having it on the top. So I have less space. So if I put it all at the bottom, I have a lot more space here to go and add more commands to my quick access toolbar. So how do you populate your quick access toolbar? So if you can see, and if I have these, you can see I have the align options right here. So if I just go here and I say that I want to take these two and align them to left, I can just clearly go here and say align left. I don't have to go to 3 or 4 commands there to find out where that option is. It's just there for me instantly as I want it. But how did I get the align button here? So I'm just going to go to the home tab, arrange, align, right click, and say add to quick access toolbar. I don't have that available here because it's already on the quick access toolbar. You can only add something which is not already there. So let's go and add something which is not there. So maybe I'll just go and to quick styles, right click and say add to quick access toolbar. Notice I have nothing in this area. The last button is a format painter. The moment I say add to quick access toolbar, this new button is come to the quick access toolbar. Okay, so I have shape quick styles and that's all there, right there. I don't have to visit anywhere. I can just have this shape selected here. Go to quick styles and apply any of the styles that I like over here. And you can, you know, do that. It's almost a click. So that's how we add content to the quick access toolbar. The other thing is, how do you get more area of the ribbon? So suppose I want to do something on the slide. Maybe I have something which is very minute, something which is this small, or I have a shape that is, let's say I have got a star here. And I want to go and zoom it over there. So I can actually go and zoom it as much as I want. I can go to 400%. At this point of time, it's okay. But what if it was like this and I was not able to see everything here? So what I could do is I need more area here. So what I can do is I can double click on any of the ribbon tabs and it gives me more area there. And I have stuff there. The keyboard shortcut for this is Ctrl F1. So if I press Ctrl F1, second. So it goes and hides this area, but it still allows the ribbon tabs and the quick access toolbar to show through. If you want to hide that too, what you can do is you can go to your account and there's a button next to that, ribbon display options. You can just say auto hide ribbon, it hides everything. So it's all gone, and you can have the whole area to zoom in as much as you want. And so the zoom option is also gone away. The toolbar is, the status bar is also gone away. So I'm just holding the control key and using my mouse rolling thing to roll it out over there, and I can zoom it over there. So I have a lot of area to work with that, especially when you have really complicated slides with four charts or four tables, and you need to really go into zoom into a big area and see what's there. Then, you know, this is very helpful. Or if you're drawing something in PowerPoint, you really need more area so that you can get the screen real estate that the ribbon is taking. To get it back, you can just go onto the top over here, ribbon display option, and show tabs and commands, and get back to where you normally are. Okay, so I'm just going to close the selection pane as well now. So we learned how to collapse the ribbon now. Next option, let's go and duplicate our stuff by dragging. So I have this stuff. I've already shown you the keyboard shortcut Ctrl D to duplicate, and that duplicates everything. But, you know, even faster, hit the Ctrl key, drag it, leave it anywhere, and you can make as many copies as you want. Okay, so I'm just going to undo that. What if I don't want to just drag it? What if I want to drag it a straight line? So I hold Ctrl plus Shift. I'm holding both the Ctrl and the Shift keys and dragging now. And you notice that PowerPoint only duplicates in a straight line, either right, bottom, top, or left. And that's all you can do. So sometimes this is a great option. You can just go and notice the smart guides. These are only available in the newer versions of PowerPoint, including PowerPoint 365. If some of you are using older versions like 2007, 10, or 13, then you don't have these options. So the best part is I can have them all equidistant. So the ways to do that is holding the Control key and dragging them. And the second one is to holding both the Control and the Shift keys and dragging them as we did now. An easier way to just put them all equidistant, even if you have an older version, is something I'm going to show you how to do that now. So Control D duplicates, as we know. But Control D does something else. It also remembers your duplication patterns. So what is a duplication pattern? Let's go and learn that. So I hit Control D now, and now I'm just going to use my mouse cursor, my keyboard arrow keys, and I'm going to take it somewhere else. Maybe I'm just going to put it like this. Now you see the relationship between shape one and shape two, the spacing, and also that shape two is below shape one. Now when I hit Control D, it's going to remember that pattern. And you can see it's making a real staircase over there. So when you make a staircase graphic or something, and you can just make it quickly like that. Now this, and the best part is if you want to add text to all your shapes, all you have to do, I told you PowerPoint is always selection and action. So select your shape and start typing. That's all you have to do. The reason I want to emphasize this is because I have seen a lot of people, when they want to add text to a shape, they actually go take a text box, drag it on top of the shape, and start typing in that. So you don't have to do that. You can actually select the shape itself and type after selecting the shape. That's all. So much faster. So let's go and do this Control D trick one more time. Here we are, and I am pressing Control D. So before I press Control D, let's do something else with this one. Okay, let me do Control D one more time. Get this here and this one here. I'm going to overlap this one with this shape, and I'm going to change the color. And now I'm going to select both of them and group them. The keyboard shortcut for grouping is Control G. If you're using the Mac version of PowerPoint, it's Command G. So I have grouped it. So now it behaves like one object. So I'm going to make it a little smaller. And now I hit Control D. And let me just go here and get this. And now keep hitting Control D again. So it creates an entire pattern over there, depending on, it's very easy to create graphics like that, something you want with accurate values to line up properly and stuff like that, which is very difficult to do without using the Ctrl D option, and you can quickly get them working. And it's not necessary that you have to go diagonal. You can even do it in a straight line. So it even works in a straight line. It depends on how you want to get it done. Okay. So how are we doing on time, Alinda?
So we have more 25 minutes.
Perfect. So I think we are good. And do we have any questions to address at this point in time?
Not as of now, sir.
Very well. Thank you so much. Okay. So now we'll go into looking at inserting photos quickly with photo album. Okay. Now photo album is one feature which has been there for 15, 18, I don't know how many years in PowerPoint, or maybe more than 20 years. It's always been there for a long, long time. But a lot of people don't use it because it's probably a little laid back and a little confusing, but it's a very important time-saving feature. So let's go and look at this one. So I'm just going to share with you my folder here, which has got a bunch of photos. So there you go. I have like 50 pictures here, and I want to put them all individually on one slide in PowerPoint. I could actually go and add a new slide here. And then I say insert picture from file from this device. And then I can go to that particular folder and insert a picture, then add another slide and add another picture and do that. But I don't have to do that. So what I can do is I can just choose the insert photo album option and say new photo album. Now, one very important factor that you have to consider here is that it's not going to add these pictures in the presentation that we are working on. Photo album always creates a new PowerPoint presentation. So I'm just going to open the photo album dialog box. Don't get confused by seeing it in the same presentation, because when we are done, it's going to make it as a new presentation. It's got nothing to do with our existing presentation. So I'm going to copy the path to my images, choose the file disk option in the photo album dialog box, and this is where my pictures are. Again, you all know that the keyboard shortcut key for selecting everything is Control A. So I hit Control A again, say insert, and by magic, 50 pictures are already there into our presentation here. Okay. So I'm just going to say create, and that's all I have to do. And it's going to create one slide per presentation. One picture per slide. There you go. And you don't have to worry about anything. It's all there. Okay. If you are running PowerPoint 2000, PowerPoint 365, you'll also get the design ideas option. I'm just going to leave that for now. And because our next hack is on design ideas, and we'll get there that time. But you notice it created a new presentation. So what if we actually now want to change it? I don't want one picture per slide. I want four pictures per slide. So no problem. Go to your insert tab again, photo album. And now you have a new option available here, which says edit photo album. So if I go and choose edit photo album, and I have all the same photos there, rather than choosing the picture layout to be fit to slide, I'm just going to choose four pictures. And I'm going to say update. And it gets updated instantly there. Can you see that? So you can quickly go and create your photo album presentation like that. But what if you don't want to use this as a separate presentation? What if you wanted to get these slides in this particular presentation that we have behind the scenes here? So what we're going to do in that case is I'm just going to select this presentation. And one sec. Let me go and close this. I have two presentations open at this point in time, right? So I'm just going to go to the View tab, and I'm going to say Arrange All. So it's going to arrange both the presentations. Either the photo album is going to be on the left or this one's going to the left. It really doesn't matter. So I'm just going to go to this particular view, which is Slide Sorter View. And I'm also going to go to Slide Sorter View, which is at the you can access from the status bar here for both of them. Let me say that I want to take these two slides, number 10 and 11, and take it to this presentation. So I'm just going to go and put it here. And you know, it also takes the layout and the theme appearance of the presentation is copied too. So here it's a black one because the presentation has a black background, but this presentation has got a different background. So it maintains the appearance to the destination presentation. So even if you had to add just two or three slides, it still makes it easier and faster if you actually go and create a photo album presentation, not save your presentation, just drag these slides, get them here, and then you can just close this presentation without saving it at all. So the photo album presentation makes it so much faster and easier to do stuff like that. So let me just go and drag these two slides to where I was talking about photo album. There you go. Some notes here, you can import all these pictures with one click, few clicks rather. You can choose some layout options, that is one per slide, two per slide, four per slide. You have options also to go and, have captions on the slides. So what is a caption there? So if I just go again here to insert photo album, okay, one second. Edit photo album. You can see I have an option called four pictures with title, and I say update. Now it's, it doesn't have any option. Title is a title of the slide. Okay, so it adds a title. You can put a description there. I'm just going to remove that for now and just retain it as four pictures. The other option is captions below all pictures and all pictures black and white and update it. Imagine 50 pictures, just update in one click, okay? Now the caption, it just takes a file name. So if you rename the files to descriptive names, it's going to take the same captions. The best part is you can always go and choose edit photo album and remove the captions again and it's updated again. So everything happens almost instantaneously with 50 pictures or 100 pictures or 200 pictures. So that really, really makes it fast. So if you have black and white pictures and you saved your file and closed your PowerPoint presentation, and suddenly you say, I want my color pictures back. That's easy too. You just go and say edit photo album again, remove the option that says all pictures black and white, and miraculously all your pictures turn back to color. Okay. So with that, let's go to our next hack, which is using PowerPoint Designer. Now remember, PowerPoint Designer only works if you're using PowerPoint 365 on Windows or Mac, which is the subscription version. To some extent, it also works on PowerPoint on the web, which is a PowerPoint online option, which is on OneDrive.com, okay? But it all works in the browser. It is not as full featured. But if you're working with an older version of PowerPoint, which doesn't have these features, you can use the web version, which is also available as a free option. Okay, so let's go and look at what you can do with this thing, these big photo album slides that we have. And we'll just go to design and say design ideas. It's not coming here because I copied it from another presentation. So let's go to the original presentation. So you can see what we have here. I can choose this option, which gets pictures wider and clearer. And the options that you see are going to differ from person to person. It's also going to differ from day to day because Microsoft keeps adding new layouts. So what you see after a week is going to be different from what we're going to see today. And you can see there are more design ideas which are loading. Unreal, some really cool ones are there. And you can play with these over there and add them as needed. Just need a sip of water. Give me a moment. Okay. So, and now what I have done is I have already created, just to save time, I've already created a presentation where the same pictures are there and I chose a particular layout. And let me get rid of this music clip here, which I added. I'm going to show you how to add it. And you can see that these pictures have slides have been added. That's so quick. It hardly takes 2 or 3 minutes to get something like this done. It probably takes you a larger time, amount of time to go and choose pictures, but going and putting them all together doesn't take a long time. Okay. So that's how it's going to work. So that was about PowerPoint Designer, also known as Design Ideas. So now let's go and add sound across slides. So what if you want your presentation, especially a photo album presentation like this one, to have some sound playing over there? At this point of time, if I go and play my presentation, you'll notice there's no sound here because we haven't added any sound. A lot of people want to add sound to PowerPoint, but they have a real problem because they hit a stumbling block. So let's go and see what are the type of sound files that PowerPoint can accept. So you can use WMA files, you can use WAV files, you can use MP3 files. MP3 files are the most common these days, so I'm going to use that. Whatever you use, make sure you respect copyrights and only use sound clips that you can legally use, okay? So we just go to the Insert tab, we go to the first slide, choose the audio option, choose audio on my PC, and I'm going to choose one of the sound clips I have here. And the sound clip comes here. Let's test the sound. So as you can see, it's playing here. But the moment you select the sound clip, you find two other options on the ribbon, audio format and playback. So let me go down again and deselect the sound. You see those options are not there. The moment I select the sound, I get audio format and playback. Let's be on the playback tab of the ribbon and start automatically. So the moment you play a presentation, the music will start playing. Play it across slides. That means that when you move to the next slide, the presentation, the music should still be playing. Loop until stop means if it's a clip that's over, your music is finished playing and you still have more slides, then it's going to loop the sound also. So it's going to start the sound all over again. So remember, these are the three options you need. There's also an option called rewind after playing and hide during show. What hide during show is going to do is you go and look at this stuff over there. And did you see that this clip showed over there at that point of time? You could choose hide during show, or you could do what I do. I just drag this clip and put it outside the slide area because music has got to be heard, not seen. So it doesn't matter if it's not on the slide. And now you can see. This is how it's going to happen. Let's save our presentation. You'll notice that I have the save option also in the quick access toolbar. Okay, so now this is done. We added sound clips, okay? So now let's move on to our next and last option, which is quickly, what if you want to share your presentation? What if you made even your regular presentation, what if you want to share it? You don't want to send the PowerPoint file to anyone. You want to make sure that you can send a PDF, but the PDF will not have any music or animation or anything else, right? So what if you wanted to share on YouTube or Vimeo, so or any other online platform like Facebook? So again, you will want to export your PowerPoint presentation to a video format. How do you do that? So we'll take again our photo album presentation. We'll choose the file option. Go to export, create a video, and you can choose full HD here. You can use ultra HD here and high definition and standard. You can take any of them. The only thing is the two aspects here. If you take the higher quality ones, they'll take longer to render, one. And second, they will also have a larger file size. So if I choose a larger file size now, it could probably going to have us all wait for 10, 15 minutes waiting for it to render. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to go to this presentation and I'm just going to these slides. I'm just going to get rid of all but three slides here because I want it to be fast and rendered. I'm going to save it as a smaller one, photo album smaller. And then I'm going to come here, file, export, create a video. I'm just going to take HD 720p, create a video. By default, it's going to create in the same folder where you save with the same name with the MP4 extension. And let's wait. And you can see down here, it's rendering. Since it's only three slides, it doesn't take a long time to render. And that's great because that's how we want it to happen. Trust me, the only difference in having 50 slides or 100 slides and 3 slides, it's the time it's going to take to render. It's done. So let's go and open our presentation. Give me a moment. I'll find that a place where this is saved. So there you can see, this is a file. It's 3.5 megabytes and let's go and play it. Can easily upload these files to YouTube or anywhere else you want to share, and you can share it with your friends, colleagues, business partners, or anyone who wants to share with. Let's close this one. So that was about it. Let's move on to the rest of our content. So here's a small tip. What if you're in the middle of a presentation and you suddenly want to hide your presentation? Because maybe someone has stepped into the room and you have disclosed an information that you can't disclose there. So you can quickly click the B button on your keyboard and your screen gets black. And you can click it B again and it comes back. Same way you can hit white for W for white. It becomes white, hit W again and you get back. It only works with black and white, no other colors. And what do I do? I write books on PowerPoint and presenting. I do training, create better presentation fast. And I've been awarded MVP, that's most valuable professional for PowerPoint, for 20 years now from Microsoft. You can learn more. That's my website, indesign.com. That's my Twitter handle, Facebook page, and LinkedIn contact page. All this information will be provided in the small PDF document that I'm going to link from under the description on the YouTube page. Look for it tomorrow on the same YouTube page. And what you'll receive in that PDF, you'll get a link to my subscription for my newsletter. And when you subscribe, you'll get a free copy of my ebook, 10 Tips for Cool PowerPoint Charts. You'll also get a promo code for 75% discount. You get a link to book me for a one-to-one call as needed, and you'll get my social media links. With that, I'm going to hand it back to Erlinda. So, yes, Erlinda.
Thank you so much, sir. So we have a couple of questions.
Yes, please tell me.
Is there any possible way to collage more than 4 photos?
To put more than 4 photos? Of course, it's possible, but not in photo album, okay? So let me show you something. Since you have PowerPoint Designer anyway, right? So if I have these pictures here and I have, let's say you wanted 6 photos or you wanted 8 photos. Okay, so I'm going to take 8 of them and I'm just going to drag them onto the slide here. And all 8 of them are there. So I'm just going to, it's not showing any ideas there because the layout is different. I'm just going to make it blank there. One second. For some reason, it's not showing. Give me a moment. It's showing design ideas, but I've already deleted all the photos once. So, okay, I have one photo here. So I'm going to drag a second photo. You don't have to worry about them being one on top of the other because design ideas will take care of all of that. 3, 4. So question was having more than 4. So let me go and put this one, 5. We still have photos there. Design ideas sometimes has a limit on 8 or 9 photos. So that's the limit you can put in to get that over there. So we've hit 6 now. Let me add one more. So now we have 7 photos. So it's not giving. So at 6, it was giving us with 6 photos, but sometimes it gives for 9 photos as well. So now you have different options there, and you can have 6 photos arranged in a proper way. You have more options because you have more photos there. So or if you just want a simple one to have 6 abreast, like how you have with photo album, that's possible too. So does that answer your question?
Yes, certainly.
But this is only going to work in PowerPoint 365. I need to tell you that part.
Can we format design ideas, like for if I have 5 presentations and like the 5 slides?
Yes.
And the same structure, for example, here we have 6 photos. So same structure if I want on all the 6 slides. Can I format?
Absolutely, you can. You remember the last format that you use over here is always the one on the top here, okay? Do you see that on the design ideas task screen?
Yes.
So the moment I go and add another 6 pictures here, the first topmost option will always be the one that we used last, okay? So let me go and take 3, 4, 5, 6 pictures here. See, the top one is always the one you use last.
Okay.
So if I use this one now, okay, and then I go and add another slide. So PowerPoint makes it easy for you to, you know, to get to the same layout rather than scrolling down all the time. The last slide layout that you use in design ideas will always be the topmost one. Here it's the second one because we used 2 of them, right? So both the ones that you used over the first and the second are still here. So you don't have to go to bottom to find them. The ones that you use last are always on the top.
Is there any way to go back while not using the design idea, but what I originally designed without using design idea?
Let's try it out. 1 second. So to do that, let's go to design ideas. There's no quick way of doing that, but you can get them at least back to squares again. Then you can select every individual picture, go to picture format and say reset picture and size. And then you go individually to, or you can select, I don't know if you can multiple select this. Let's go and try that. Yes, it works. So all of them back to how it was. We caused a mess, but we got back to what we started with. Okay, does that answer your question?
Yes. What is the best way or tool to compress the file? Do you recommend any tool to compress?
Sure. See, there are lots of options. Okay, the first thing you have to remember is the PowerPoint is much more efficient than it used to be. So the moment you insert a picture, to a certain extent, it goes and compresses your file within the presentation when you save it, okay? And so it's not the same size as how it was earlier. So let me just go and say save options here, 1 second. If I go and say save as, and save. Okay, so now what I'm gonna do is, these things keep changing, so let's hope we find that, okay? So we go to advanced and there you can see image size and quality. Okay, so you can say default resolution is high fidelity, which is what it's doing now. If you want to get it down to 96 PPI, you can choose that and do that and hit file save, and automatically PowerPoint will compress them to 96 PPI and make the file size smaller. It's important that you save the file first because it's asking, this is setting is per file, the image size and quality for this PowerPoint file, right? That was the reason I went and saved the file earlier. So, and then you can change the default resolution. By default, it is high fidelity, but you can go and change it to down to as much as you want. So I'm letting it be high fidelity. The other thing you can do is you can use third-party plugins. There's a well-known plugin called NX Powerlite. Let me see if I can share their website with you. Give me a moment. So this is it. So they have a wonderful tool where you can not only compress your PowerPoint files, but also Word and Excel files and PDFs and make them smaller. So it's a paid tool, definitely. And I will put details on this on the PDF that I provide. But Nux Power, the company that creates NX Power Lite, and they have been in the business for 10, 12 years. And I remember being on the beta with them. They also created a wonderful new product called WeCompress. I think it's WeCompress.com. Let's check it out. Yes, it is. And this is an online, okay? So you can drag your PowerPoint presentations here, and you can take your Excel and Word files, PDFs also, and it's going to compress it for you free of cost, and then you can download it. And always when you do something like that, make a copy of a presentation, because just in case you lose something, you have a backup. So did I answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you. One last question from my side out of a personal interest. I see that you use some plugins and add-ons. Any recommendation on that?
Oh, I love these plugins and add-ons. A lot of these add-in developers send me their plugins. They want me to play with it and get them feedback and stuff like that. And I do features on them on my website, indesign.com. We have interviews with these people all about PowerPoint stuff. So I have three plugins which I enabled here, okay? One is iSpring Suite, where you can actually create e-learning content from within PowerPoint. The two other products, very well-known products, one is Articulate and the other is Adobe Presenter and Adobe Captivate. They work together and they allow you to create add-in content. They work as add-ins to create e-learning content from within PowerPoint, okay? They're very expensive tools, but they do a great job. The second thing I'm using here is Tools too. Now, I really, really, really like this tool a lot. And it's got a multitude of features. You can see it's got so many crammed features. I think it's around $20. That's all it is. It's really worth it. Then there's this tool called UTools, which is an older version of the same product, which now is called BrightSlide from a company called Bright Carbon. This is totally free, BrightSlide, and I'll definitely put a link to that in the PDF that I sent to you all.
Wonderful, thank you. Over to you, Alinda.
So we have some more questions.
Go ahead. We probably can do 5 minutes more, if that's okay.
Yeah, sure, sir. Can we have time limit set up while making video of presentation?
We would love to. The person who asked the question, can they paraphrase it? Can we have a time limit set up when we are exporting a video? Is that the question?
Yes, sir.
So see, these are three slides that we have here. Okay. So when we go and say file export, it's going to tell you create video. It's going to tell you seconds spent on each slide. So it's 5 seconds here. So it's going to be a 15-second video. Okay. Now, this is going to only happen for slides that don't have any timings. So if I actually want a time limit that is not 15 seconds, I could go to the transition tab here and say that I want advances mouse click after say 20 seconds. Okay, so this becomes 20 seconds and I'm going to say apply to all. 1 second. So all three of them become 20 seconds now. So now when I export, video is going to be 60 seconds. Okay, so it depends on what timings I put in the slide. And that is what the video is going to respect. You can also have two slides with 20 seconds and one slide with no timing. In that case, you will just go to the file export option, choose create a video. And over there, you can type in whatever timing you want. And this is reflective for slides that don't have any slide timings of their own. So that answers that question, Alinda.
Okay, so we have two more questions.
Absolutely, go ahead.
How distribute and align option work in align to slide and align selected object?
So there are two different things over there. So now you look at this particular circle. Can you see that circle over there? So when you actually go to the align tools here, it is already selected as align to slide because I have selected only one object. Okay. So when I select two objects, you see the align slide option is, one second. I think this thing works better with none of these designer slides. Let's just go to our original presentation where we have stuff like this. Okay, so let me just randomize these. So when I have one object selected, it says align to slide. When I have multiple objects selected, it stays aligned to slide, but actually when I go and say align top, they're going to align it to the top. You see that? Okay, so when you align to slide, when you have one object selected, you individually say align to slide and you say align center and you say align middle, what it's going to do, it's going to choose the slide as the anchor and then go and align them all together. Now my alignment tools are working here a little differently because I have a add-in called U-Tools installed and that takes over the alignment options from PowerPoint. So that's not disabled at that point of time. So if I would just go to, I don't know, options, add-ins, and go to, where is U-Tools? It's an active application add-in. And I'm going to disable that. So I don't have U-Tools anymore. Now if I say align, now it's a key in align to slide. I can just go and say align selected objects manually there. And now what's going to do is, if I have these three, it's going to see which is the leftmost, okay? The leftmost object is this one. So if I say align left, it's going to align it to the leftmost. Let me undo that and see which is the rightmost. This is the rightmost. If I say align right, it's going to do it align to the rightmost object. Let me undo that again and say align center. What's going to take? It's going to take the leftmost and the rightmost, get an average of that and align everything to that anchor. So let's undo that. On the other hand, if I have align to slide selected, it's going to take all of them and align it to the edge of the slide if I say align left. Undo it. If I say align to the right, it's going to align to the right end of the slide. So it's actually going and you, when you say align to slide, it's using the slide as the anchor. Align to the selected objects, it's choosing one of the objects as an anchor depending on what you've chosen. Yes, Alinda.
So I think...
You can ask the last question, Alinda. I think it's important. About the size of the PowerPoint.
Okay, sometimes the size of the PPT becomes very large. We are unable to share it on mail. It is due to multiple graphical image, which might be linked with Excel file. Any easy way of removing those links in less?
See, one thing is there, since this is we have a fair number of Excel users in this audience, a lot of people just copy Excel and paste it into PowerPoint, okay? So that is probably not the best way to do it. What would be the best way to, and it's best not to link it as also. So you can just choose copy from Excel. Let me see if I have an Excel file open here. Because I don't have a sample Excel file ready available here, which with data that I can share on the screen. So I'm just going to open one of the sample Excel files available from Microsoft. So I've downloaded something called a summer activity template, okay? So this is definitely not like the Excel files that all of us see. Okay, but so let me take this Excel file and I'm going to copy this. And when you come here, add a new slide, you're going to say paste. Don't just go and choose any of these options. Choose paste special. And then you can choose HTML format because that's going to make sure that it's a table. The one disadvantage of using the HTML format option is that I'll come to that, but make sure that you choose paste and don't choose a paste link option here. Always use a paste option because by default it's going to, if you choose paste link, it have a link to the Excel object. Also in paste, you can see the default option is Excel worksheet object. So it's going to paste the whole Excel content over there and really, really balloon up your file size. So let's go and choose HTML format here. Click OK. It's going to get there. The big problem here between this content and what you see in the Excel is a text size is very small compared to what was there over there. So that's easily fixed. Just select your stuff over here, go to the home tab, and 1 second. I'm going to select all of them, and I can just go and increase the font size to whatever I want. Okay, so that's how it one way of working it. Now, Excel is not the only culprit. You will have to use a lot of pictures, and depending on the questions that Shreyans asked earlier, it's also possible to go and choose a resolution of the image. Also, you can take any PowerPoint image and put it on WeCompress or NX PowerLight, and it's definitely going to reduce the file size. As I said, WeCompress is free. You can go and upload your file and download it, and you will get that stuff over there. It shows you it actually compresses the file for you free of cost. So that's a great option. So just take a combination of all these options, and then you can actually go and have a much smaller file size. Another way of looking at that, sometimes you already, that these are best practices for content that you're going to create in the future. What about content that you already have with big sizes? Okay, so a lot of times you can't understand how to do that stuff like that. So what I do is I have this program called Slidewise that is also from the same company which creates NX PowerLight and WeCompress. So you go and say show hide Slidewise. It's an add-in. So it's going to take a moment. I clicked it. Okay. So it's thinking, it's going to find out what the embedded chart data, how much size the images are taking, which image is taking exactly how much. And you can find out which where this image is there, what is the file size. So you can actually go and find out where exactly your bloat in the file size is coming from. So you know exactly which slide the problem is. So at least you don't have to guess work at that point of time. You can really go and figure out where that content is. And if before I used to have Slidewise, what I would do is if I have a 12-slide presentation, I would divide that into two presentations of 6 slides, and then you can find out which is a presentation which is bigger in file size. So you know the culprit is in those 6 slides, and then you can take a factor of removing content and then go and you really go and isolate the problem slide over there and then find out the problem and solve it. So you have to take a combination of all these approaches and get the result you're looking for.
Thank you so much, sir. That was indeed an informative session. And on behalf of Excel and Excel, I thank you for taking time and sharing your wisdom.
Sure. And I would also. I just want to end on one note here that you can also inform the audience that by tomorrow, I will send you all the PDF with. I'll send links to all the things we have referred to here today. And share it with all of you all so that you can share it with the audience.
Yeah, sure, sir. We'll do that. I would also like to extend our thanks to all the participants for your time and support. We appreciate you being here. Hope this session was useful. We have a couple of announcements. Excel and Excel has recently launched EIE Learning. EIE Learning is a set of hand-picked online courses conducted by working professionals curated on a gamut of subjects, starting from Tally to Excel and analysis to Power BI. Our courses help you to upskill yourself and will help you become indispensable during these trying times. Here are some of the upcoming courses. Microsoft Excel Essentials. It is Athena's course content, which will be starting from 19th October. We have 2 batches, one in the morning and in the evening. The morning batch will run from 7:30 a.m. to 9 o'clock a.m. The evening batch will run from 7 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. And we have a course on robotic process automation, RPA, using UiPath. It's a 15-hour course content starting from the 22nd of October. Please note, our courses are not pre-recorded. They are live sessions with experienced instructors. Our courses include learning new, hidden, and unexplored features, real work examples, digital certificate, access to entire session recording, hands-on experience, limited batch size. As we celebrate the 10th anniversary of Excel and Excel, we offer courses discounted up to 50% on their regular price. Hence, I would encourage you all to make use of this golden opportunity as we have only limited seats available. In order to apply, please visit our website on the screen. an announcement for all regarding our upcoming Fresh Talk. On 16th October, we have a session on predictive analytics use cases for risk assessment by CAS Deepika. Thanks again for joining us today, and we will see you in our next session. Do not forget to like the video. For more updates, subscribe to our channel. To know more on EIE Fresh Talk, use the link in the description box. Stay tuned for more Fresh Talk. Have a happy weekend, and thank you all.